The last views of the Schleißheim camp as a Bulanov left for Bremerhaven by train, destination America, would travel by train to the Interzonal Embarkation Center, the port of embarkation there in Bremerhaven. We came to this camp for a final processing before embarking to America. It took 2 weeks to process us there. Sometimes during the time we were there, I would go outside the camp. I was shocked when I saw the city of Bremerhaven. There was not a building standing that I could see. There was nothing but piles of rubble as far as the eye could see, except for the skeleton of one building which had a metal frame. Metal frame construction was unusual construction at that time. You didn't see many people outside of the camp. I don't know how people were living. Bremerhaven had been a German naval base. That's why it was so heavily bombed. There were thousands of people in the camp at the embarkation center, all ready and anxious to start life anew. This picture was only the mess hall. You were only allowed to bring your clothes and personal family items for the voyage ahead. At last, we boarded an army transport ship that had taken American troops to Europe, the USS General Hershey. This actually was a Navy transport ship. I'm aboard the ship with my parents. I took this picture leaning over the ship's rail in October 1951. The USS General Hershey was loaded with DPs. There were 1,370 of us DPs aboard. Women and children were separated from the men. Women were in the bow, men were amidship. Displaced persons were expected to stay in their area unless they were on work detail. Adults were assigned work duty, although most of the women were seasick for the entire voyage. One of the jobs I had was sweeping and cleaning the decks. Also, I was assigned to move supplies. When I was doing this, I worked way down in the storeroom. A photo of a ship passing our ship as we were moving toward the ocean. Those are the white cliffs of Dover in the background. The open ocean. Crossing was very stormy for the entire 18-day voyage, and most passengers were terribly seasick. You were only allowed on deck while on work detail, under supervision of sailors. Then you held on to ropes to prevent you from being washed overboard. There was hardly anyone in the mess to eat because everyone was so sick. The women were terribly seasick. Once I needed a place to throw up, and I did not know where to go. So I put my head in the anchor hole. Just then, the waves came up and washed over my head. Sunset in the open ocean. Note the ship's bow at right. This is the last picture I have of our trip to America. I think I ran out of film. I still have a copy of the ship's journal. It breaks down the passenger list by nationality. 417 Poles, 401 Germans, 143 Yugoslavians, 88 Russians, 79 Latvians, 66 Lithuanians, 45 Italians, 37 Hungarians, 37 Romanians, 28 Chechnyans, 10 Estonians, 10 Austrians, 3 Chinese, 2 Bulgarian, 1 French, 1 American, 1 from Turkey and 1 from Albania. One of the entries in the journal was written by Dr. Nagi Lajos, a medical officer and a DP himself. This is his entry written on October 16, 1951, while crossing the Atlantic Ocean aboard the USS Hershey. Going to the land of freedom, there should arise many thanks toward the great people of USA, the excellent leaders of IRO, and the brave ship staff of General Hershey. Catching sight of the Statue of Liberty on the New York Bay, I feel as if I hear the great Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Come here, this is the land of freedom of speech and religion, freedom from want and from fear. America, where the freedom and happiness have been realized, where the people want and can use their mind. In the USA, where there are justice, human rights, and humanity, I gratefully think of the unselfish help which has already rescued millions of people. I would wish to God that the whole world should know and have the noble-minded sphere of ideas of this great nation. For the peace and happiness on the earth could be realized only by these ideas. God bless and help the nations of the world on their way, which will give their history more glorious continuation. The entries in the ship journals are mostly in German, though several other languages are represented also. But most of the entries ended with similar words to this entry. Good luck for the start of a new life on a new continent. God help us. The final entry is from the ship's chief of police, also a DP. As he writes, he closes with these words. And once more, my best thanks to the International Relief Organization, through whose help we find ourselves entering the land which for so long a time we have been dreaming of. Good luck to everyone aboard this ship. God bless you wherever you go. One can almost hear the anticipation and the apprehension that was in every heart and mind on that ship. America, everyone's dream, was coming true for them. Yet there was so much uncertainty and so much unknown. Where will we go? What will we do? Will we get sent back when we get to Ellis Island? How will we make a new start in a strange land with a new language? Time and time again, these new immigrants invoked the blessing of God. When the ship neared America, it was evening of October 21, 1951. Once we entered the harbor, the DPs were allowed on deck. My overcoat got white with salt from the spray of the seawater. When we entered the harbor, we saw our first view of America. The lights, the cars, the skyscrapers. It was all overwhelming. First, we saw all the lights of New York in the distance, and then all the cars' headlights as I traveled on the coast. So many cars, it was overwhelming. We were watching the traffic and seeing all the skyscrapers. It was beyond our imagination. Everyone was in awe of everything. We hadn't seen bright lights like that in more than 11 years, and we had never seen such skyscrapers. Then we came near the Statue of Liberty, and the ship dropped anchor. It truly was a symbol of hope. Especially, I had seen the factory in Paris where it was made. And now here we were. our voyage was over. We were overwhelmed. It was October 21, 1951. I was 19 years old. Everyone was wondering what was coming up. No one knew what to expect. Would anyone even meet us? The next worry was getting through Ellis Island. We had heard that you could be sent back for many reasons. We could not understand why we had dropped anchor at the Statue of Liberty. Eventually, we learned that the dock workers were on strike. Plans were for the ship to dock at Ellis Island, but because of a strike, they could not. We were so relieved that we did not have to go to Ellis Island. The ship stayed at anchor for 3 days, then proceeded to the Brooklyn Navy Yard, where the Navy unloaded us and brought us through customs. Our sponsors, the Chernyshovs, were waiting for us as we came through customs. At this time, they still lived in New York, though they moved to California a few years later. We were so happy to see them. Now we were at peace. We had someone here who knew the ropes and knew what we should do. They already had a car, and I had rented a two-room apartment for us in Brooklyn at 155 Liberty Avenue. The apartment had a little furniture and some food. We were so thankful.